Bill, please. I want us to look this morning at 2 Timothy chapter 3. I have been studying a lot of things this week, and I tried my best to run away from this one, but the Lord keeps bringing back to me, so I ask you to stand with me, if you're physically able to do so, when you find the portion of Scripture, 2 Timothy chapter 3. This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women, laden with sins, led away with divers lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. But they shall proceed no further, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men, as theirs also was. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. Father, we pray again in Jesus' name for this service. We ask you, Lord Jesus, to speak clearly to our hearts today and help us, Lord Jesus, to make solid decisions about our faithfulness to the Lord Jesus Christ and being certain that we are a part of the remnant of God.
Yeah.
Deliver us from false professions. Take us, Lord Jesus, back to the cross and help us see ourselves first as a people needing repentance and needing a changed life by the grace of God. We love you, Lord Jesus, and we ask you now to bless our church family and again cause the Lord Jesus Christ to be glorified in our midst. We beg these things, and we would also ask you to fill us with the Spirit of God. Lord, revive thy work in the midst of the years, and in wrath, remember mercy. In Jesus' name. precious name. Amen. You can be seated. I thank the Lord this morning for the privilege to come back to a portion of Scripture that has been one of those portions of Scripture that has kept me through the years. The book of 1 Timothy, Titus, and 2 Timothy all have to do with pastoral care. It's interesting that these books on the ministry and how to carry out ministry, all three of them put the emphasis upon sound doctrine. In fact, as you read through these books, and I've taught you that to the point that I can say it now, what is the theme of the pastoral epistle, and our young people say sound doctrine. And that's a blessing to me. But what we see in this is that in each of these three books, it gives us real insight on how we protect the Word of God. And that's seen in chapter 1, 2, 3, and 4, even to 6 in 1 Timothy. And sometime I've got time, we'll go back through them, because these books have been strength to us here at Peachtree through the years. Look with me, for instance, in 1 Timothy. Look at chapter 4. Look at verse 1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of demons. It's important to understand, as the Word teaches us in 2 Corinthians 11, that it is important that we understand that there is a time of apostasy that will come upon our land. And it teaches us that they will substitute doctrines of devils. They will give us another Jesus, another gospel, and the Bible tells us another spirit. And I share with you, we're living in such times. Probably we need to stop and just say for a moment, the last days are from the cross of Calvary to the coming of the Lord Jesus. Right. And what's so important in the whole thing is that we're in the latter part of the last days. And therefore, we must be discerning. And here we see in chapter 4 of 1 Timothy that now the Spirit expressly teaches us or speaks to us that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith. Now another word for departing from the faith is actually apostasy. So it has to do with a falling away. Apostasy is a falling away from the faith. We've had several testify in the last few weeks to me and to others that their heart is broken because their children and their grandchildren are departing from the faith. Let me just share this with you. It's true that there are false teachers and those that are here, but I want this church during these crisis times and the days ahead to be certain to stand as the remnant of God, discerning the spirits, whether they be the Holy Spirit or they be demons. Let me just say to you, it's important for us to contend for the faith. He said in Jude that we are to earnestly contend for the faith. Now, in the book of Titus, we have the truths concerning the fact that we are to practice or live according to the doctrines of the Word of God. Then he comes back to 2 Timothy, and that's where I'm going to settle down this morning and maybe even tonight to talk to you about the fact that the Bible teaches us that there's a difference in what's going on in the vaults, such as those that have a form of gods. The Greek word, form, is the idea of orthodoxy or an organized system. Morphosis. But also the next word is Eusebius. It's sound doctrine Godliness is the work of the Holy Spirit in changing us by the grace of God from within out.
Amen.
If you've not been changed from within out, then you need to be born again.
Right.
Let me just say it clearly. It's very, very important we understand that we're living in a day when religion has been made something of entertainment. And it's sad. It's really sad. I think of the word amusement. To be amused is not to think. Amuse is to think. And then amusement is no thinking. We prove that every time we go to Six Flags and cry on one of those crazy rides. But the truth that there is no thinking that goes on in our churches today. Men are not thinking and reasoning through the Scriptures, the Word of God. I want to say to you that in chapter 3, we see that what it has produced. It has produced perilous times. Look at it there in verse 1. This know also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. I want to say this and say it emphatically. The idea of perilous times is times that are reckless. It's interesting that these are times that are dangerous and perplexing, and these are not easy times. You know, we have a generation that is producing a form of godliness. You go through the system, but there's no change to life. And let me plead with you to understand, if your life has not been changed by the grace of God into a living faith and a living for Christ Jesus and His glory, the chances are you're not saved.
Yep.
Now, what we need to understand is that we have gotten soft on certain issues that were always paramount in the early days of this church and in my own life. I remember that we were not afraid of the Holy Spirit. We could come to the house of God and we could go away from the house of God knowing that we've been to church. You would go to the house of God and you'd sit and listen to preaching and teaching, and the saints of God were encouraged.
Hey.
I can remember days when I was a young preacher that we went to the house of God expecting God to visit us.
Yes,
in fact, we went to the house of God with that in our very heart. Oh, God,
hey,
unless you condescend to us. I've heard some of the Reformed brethren make a statement like this. Well, He's with us. Why do we need Him to condescend upon us? He's already here. He lives in each one of us. I got news for you. He does live in us, and He chastens those whom He loves. And to come and visit you is not necessarily mean, though the Scriptures does say that there is a place for us to pray that the Spirit of God would come down and give us the presence of God and the knowing of God. You know about God, you can even be indwelt by the Holy Spirit and living for God, but you have a problem in the fact that you don't sense His reality in the place. And let me plead with you, when He's real, you'll get back to the house of God. You get in there on Sunday morning and God's real and manifesting Himself. And these are difficult times, are they? I'm amazed at how wicked the church, manifest church, is today being demonstrations of this thing of having a form. They go through the form, but they don't go through it like the Old Testament saints and the New Testament saints have and did. So it's perilous times, dangerous times, perplexing times. The idea of perplexing time means that there are no simple answers. We got ourselves into a religious bind, and we can't. We got triple marriages, my kids, and her kids. It's all divided up. I want to say this, it should never be that way.
Right.
Right.
the difficulties that we have today are the result of our having form of godliness and not power thereof. Notice with me, if you will, it goes on to say, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. If you leave out the true preaching of the Word of God and leave out Holy Spirit anointing teaching from any assembly, it will lead to a last day that marks that body of believers as having lost the presence of God. For men shall be lovers of their own selves. I went through this list again of sins during this week. We have an explanation of perilous times in these next verses. It says that for men shall be lovers of their own selves. I don't know if you'll have this or not, but the hallmark of the last days is nothing but self-centeredness. I mean, everybody's got his own trumpet to blow. Everybody's got his own ministry to show. And yet at the same time, I share with you that it's not my ministry. It's not anyone's ministry. It's God's ministry. Now, you say, Pastor David, do you feel like running the aisles today? We might if we start loving Christ more than we do ourselves.
Yeah. Hey.
I go on to point out to you, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, but they want things out of selfishness. Mm-hmm. It's so sad that it's translated over into the religious world. Can I hear an amen? Right. But what has happened is that men are desirous to be the receiver of glory, and it should be God's glory.
Right.
And let me just go a step further. It will be a little while, but if we're full of self-righteousness, we're full of all of ourselves, it won't be long when God will break that down and expose it.
Yeah.
And let me just say to you, God wants us to understand that it's not what we gain. It's not covetousness, desiring things outside the will of God. It is that God gives all the glory and we give him praise through our lifestyle.
Amen.
Boasters. I'm not calling names, but there are groups of Baptists today that are absolutely full of pride. And I don't say that. I don't want that in this church. I don't want that in me.
Good. Right.
I mean, when I get around those kind of guys, they kind of make me shut up. Because I haven't got time to listen to them. It's time for us to understand that boasters, you know, there is a thing of being doctrinally sound, and it's another thing of our glory, and I'm the one who's doing this.
Right.
I got news for you, friends. You can say what you want to, but there is not a person nor a church in the whole world that can function or produce any kind of fruit unless the Holy Spirit does it.
Amen.
I go on to point out to you that boasters, they're proud. I've been preaching on 2 Chronicles 7 for the last several services, and in that, the emphasis has been on humble yourself. Let me just say this to you. Pride does away with the presence of God. I'm telling you, when we're lifted up in pride and doing our own thing and look at what we're doing, I don't care if we, one of the brethren said, Gary needs to be here to hear this. One of the brethren says, it's one of the most beautiful buildings I've ever been in. I believe it is too. But we can operate without this building.
Yes, sir.
I'm telling you, we had buildings that went to the ground in College Park. Cost us a lot of money. It burned up. You say, well, Pastor David, what's the point of that? I'm sharing with you. We operated without the buildings.
Right,
I just tell you right now, it's settled in my own heart and mind for me to make sure that I have my priorities right.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, boy. Haven't we had a bunch of inconsistency going on in our government? Every state's screwed up in a different way.
Huh.
shouldn't be here to start with. I know that probably some fear of my saying that, but it is fact that God chastens those whom he loves.
Right.
Listen to me. God's telling us in America he loves us. And he's also telling the church of the Lord Jesus Christ that you need to humble yourself and draw nigh to God, that he'll draw nigh to you.
Yeah.
Amen? And then I'm going to point out to you that the disobedience to parents. Amen. I decided when I was reading this and studying this, Miss Odell must have loved and checked with her mom and daddy about everything. You say, why is that? She lived to be 94. 94 will tell you somebody had done something right with mom and dad. Amen. But disobedience to parents. Number one, we've had parents to be disobeyed for so long that they just give up. They stop taking a stand on the Word of God and thanks God, and they say, well, let's just let it go. Let me plead with you to understand the blessing of the Lord comes when we obey His Word. They're blasphemers. Blasphemers. Some blaspheme with a life, professing to be saved and living like the world. Some have blasphemed God standing and singing out of the hymnal. Beautiful hymns today. But they stand and sing out of the hymnal. And they lie and they sing because they have no intention to worship God. No intention to obey God. But let me just say to you, they're unthankful. They're unholy. They're without natural affection. That doesn't need any explanation. The homosexuality and bestiality and boasting and all kinds of perversions, they are actually abusing by trying to convert the scriptures and the truth against sexual sin by trying to add in all of these wicked sins. Where are we, church? Are we taking a stand? I hope that we are. False accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good. Now, here it really gets descriptive. Traitors. You know, I have met folk that went along with the doctrine of the church. They went along with the things of the church until they saw that they could get a foot up and get a better position for themselves by compromise. Let me just say this to you. If you're looking for something where you can worship or you can be promoted, that's different than having a heart for the true work of God, even if it's small. Hey, listen, God's not in it. I appreciated so much the preacher, one of the preachers that we listen to all the time, and I think it's interesting that he made this statement. I did not start out to be a pastor of a large church. And he said, I've never been tempted to jump around to other churches. He said, my temptation to do that one way when I fell in love with Jesus.
Good.
He said, my heart's mind is not how big a church, but how holy a church. And I'm going to say to you that we as individuals need to understand, preacher boys, adult preachers, all of us need to put Christ first.
Yes.
And the priority is holiness and following the truth of the Word of God, not compromising. But also, another thing that's been being left out is the subject of repentance. Believe it or not, but we're living in a generation where they don't even talk about it.
Right.
Repentance is not preached on. Hell's not preached on.
Right.
Amen. Heaven's not preached on. We're living in a time where we're trying to set up our own system so we can be in contention with those that are trying for truth. Let me just go on and say they're despisers of those that are good. I don't know about you, but one of the saddest things in my heart is when I see people that are trying to compete with one another, whether it be a church. I've often said this, that young people people, they don't boast about what they've accomplished.
Right.
They boast in what Jesus Christ has accomplished through a people. Finding also that he says here that they were traitors, high-minded, lovers of pleasures, more than lovers of God. I don't know if it's hard on this, but I thank God to see you here today. And I just don't understand how people cannot love the Lord Jesus and his church so fervently they become faithful. I mean, I've had enough chasing to God in this process of our being quarantined to say to the Lord, yes, Lord, I love your church a lot more than being out of it. And for an open door, we should be striving to be in the house of God. Can I hear you?
Yes,
you say, Pastor David, these things are things that are going on in our day that we live. That's right. Traitors. Amen. I'm going to say this, you know, it's hard for all of us at times, but I'm going to be sure and pay my bills.
Yes, amen.
Amen. I'm going to die with a testimony that I know what it is to pay my bills.
Amen.
Not take advantage of people, but to ask God to do for us. Traitors, petty, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. I want to go on and point out to you, heady and high-minded. It just makes me sick when I say the words that come out of the Word of God. If you look back at verse 3, it said, without natural affections, truce breakers. The idea of truce breakers, they won't keep their word. Mm-hmm. You don't keep your word, you create problems for yourself and others too. But in verse 5, having formed godliness, but denying the power thereof, upon such a way. Now here's what I need for you to see. Number one, in this verse, he said they had a form. That means they were religious. They had a form of orthodoxy. They were religious. And they had a form of godliness. And that godliness carries with the idea of God's changing us from within out and making us pursue the things of God. Now let me just say this. From such, turn away.
Amen.
You say, Pastor, what in the world are you saying to us? I'm saying to you that we need to make sure the church that we're attending is a biblical church.
Amen.
We need to be making sure not only are they biblical, but they have a love for the Holy Spirit to be their teacher. I mean, I want to be taught the Word of God. And the real evidence of your being a child of God and a servant of the Lord is your love for the Word of God.
Yeah.
And if you have a love for the Word of God and see to it that it's rightly divided, then God will make you who you're supposed to be in your family. For instance, the husband is to be the head of the wife. The wife is to be submitted to her own husband as unto the Lord. And children are to obey the parents and submit to them that they be brought up in the nurture and admonition of the Word. Then it goes on to teach us that we are to recognize that we've had examples of this all the way through history. I'm confident that you and I are looking at the days we're living in, and we're wondering, especially those older days here, whatever happened to the church? How do we get where we get? It's easy to understand when we fail to pursue sound doctrine. I want to say to you that it says that there were those that have a form of sound doctrine, but they are denying the power thereof. In other words, they say, yeah, I like the Bible, I love the Bible, but it doesn't have any transforming power. Now let me just say this to you. I love it because it has had transforming power in my own life, amen, and you surely have in yours. I do, but point out, they deny the power thereof, and he said, when you get into church that says they believe the Bible, but they have no power, nor believe in the power of the Holy Ghost to make the word of God effectual in saving grace. He says here, denying the power thereof, he said, from such come away. Again, I point out to you, he describes that history has had this going on all the time. I heard old Brother Jim Park preach at one of our commencement services, and he said, don't be a creep. He says in this next verse, for of this sort are they which creep into houses and leave captive silly women led with sins or led away with divers lusts. The idea of creeps here, they creep into the house, not that they're literally something, they're creepy anyway. But the word there, creep, is they did not slip into the house through a side door. That was what Jude said. Jude said that they come in, slip into the local assembly, sit down beside the true believers,
right,
and they deceive. Tell you what, it's a sad thing when we would rather compromise the word of God and wind up with deceiving instruments of Satan in our local assembly. Notice with me, they creep into houses and leave captive silly women laden with sins, led away with dire lust. I used to read that portion of scripture, and I think of they creep into house, and you can lead women, silly women, into sin. And I thought he was talking about immorality or some difficulty of morals, but it's not at all. He's talking here about bringing into the local assembly with deception. Let me just say to you that you don't deceive people by giving them a word that you can, for instance, you don't have to make Jesus Lord of your life. Just come on in and join up with us. You confess your sin, but you don't have to let him rule and reign on you. You can do that later. That's heresy.
Right.
That is not in the Word of God.
Right.
And so the Bible teaches us that we must bow our knees to his lordship.
Amen.
And that's the important thing. But here, listen to this. Here's a description of the apostate. They are ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Let me just say to you, some folk are always trying to find something new to put a twist on. They got some new idea or something. I'd rather have the old little story.
Hey.
What we need to stay with is not be afraid. We got to put a little new twist on something to get a new different emphasis. Then sometimes we're setting ourselves up for deception for ourselves.
Right.
He goes on and points out about Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses. Now here are false prophets. You remember that when he says they have a reprobate mind concerning the faith. You know, all of a sudden the Bible tells us here that Moses was set aside by God to go and to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt. And then it says, and I'm really seeing clearly in this portion of scripture, and I hope you do too, that people can look like they were sound in the apostate.
Yes.
What happened? Moses went out and God told him, I want you to lead my children out of Egypt. He said, Lord, I can't speak. Let me just say that even those that think they can speak can't speak.
Right.
So what's new is the necessity of the power of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
But then let me go on and point out to you the meaning of these men's names. This word, that to you. Satan in his process seduces our sons and our daughters.
Yes, sir.
We don't have them solidly grounded. They can seduce our children. They can seduce our loved ones that reject the word of God and not stand upon it. So Moses goes through them. God says, I tell you what you do. Cast your rod down. He cast his rod down. It came a serpent. He was told to pick it up by his tail. And he picked it up by his tail and became a staff again. Then there was the turning of the water into blood. And he did that. You know what? These things that happen like that miraculously from the hand of God, the devil could reap abuse. Tell him, you better hold on to the word of God and not some silly experience. Now, there is an experience. There's a saving grace that will change you, just like the Bible does. But please understand that Janus was a illustration of how the children were deceived in Egypt, and then they seduced. Then the word Jabez means he makes rebellious. He makes rebellious. It's interesting, these guys were deceiving people. He's also making them rebellious for truth. Now I want to say this to you. Paul is saying here there are deceivers, these apostates. He said, you keep your eyes on them. And I think it's so significant that we understand here that without the consistency of God moving Moses along and helping him, you know, after a while, they couldn't reproduce the miracle. It's an amazing thing. They wouldn't have wanted to have done so anyway. Egypt, firstborn was taken. That was the last one. Then all of a sudden, they began to recognize that Jehovah God is a great and true God. And let me just say to you, in changing water, in blood into water, and vice versa, but the powers of hell are so deceptive that if we don't learn to discern, how are you going to discern whether it's the work of God or it's the work of the devil? By knowing the scriptures.
Yes.
Sound doctrine. You've got to learn the scriptures if you know how to answer it. Now, I'll pick up later on. Some of you will. I'm not too jumping up and down myself here today. I've got a confidence in my heart that the truth will make you free.
Yes, sir.
And you need to understand it. I need to understand it.
Right.
And it's not some experience we're looking for. I want to say this. I remember as a young boy, one of my grandfather's preacher friends passed away. And we were going to a certain church, my mother and family, more of my mother, because my mother brought me up in the house of God. My daddy, sometimes I wonder about his eternal destiny, I pray he's saved. He did have the right answers at the right time. I remember on one occasion, my mother going off to a funeral. And I remember it as clear as day. She came back from the funeral service, and she walked in the house. She looked at me and looked at my brother, and this is what she said. I found a church at a funeral that preaches. And the Lord willing, Sunday morning, we're going to go move to that church. You know, these little quiet moments sometimes get a hold of truth that some of the rest of us are missing. And I never will forget it. A year and a half later, God saved me in the altar of that church.
Amen.
You say, what are you saying? It was a good church, you were going to. But they didn't have what we had over the Indian Old Baptist Church. God came on scene in that place. And I remember the this is the beginning. What does the conclusion of this whole thing is? Number one, Pastor Paul's doctrine was lived out in his life. He said, "But thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me, Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me."
Amen.
I believe God can deliver us.
Yes.
You say, he goes on to say, living, continue. He lived a godly life. But what is this chapter about? If you'll look at the verse there in verse 14. "But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus." Then he hits it. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. They had a form, but denied the profit. Very important to recognize is profit to work unto and for God as a witness through his born-again remnant to be a witness to the rest of the world. You say, "Pastor David, what do you say?" I believe that if we'll look at this thing like we should, you say, "Pastor, what's going on? I cannot. I just can't grasp it when we got all these different so-called large denominations with no change. I mean, their houses are full." I try to be reasonable. When you get 73-year-old, you're just a little more reasonable, I guess. But I don't want to be reasonable and give up holiness.
Right. Amen.
I will reason it away and make every kind of excuse what everybody else is doing. And then all of them are doing different ways and doing their own thing.
Right.
I believe that God saves sinners and changes.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, the question is, where are you? Has there been a change in your life? Is there a longing and thirsting for the Word of God and things of God? I tell you what, I'm thankful. Elijah prayed, "Lord, shut up the heavens that did not rain. Lord, let our land see the difference." See their sin and repent of their sin. And a lot of us have been praying that. Then when God sends it, he lets it happen on the righteous and the unrighteous. And then we look around and say, "This is tough business that I'm going through right now." Well, Elijah prayed that it not rain, and God stopped the rain. And Elijah had to get out there and scramble around and find bread and water too. Let me just say this too. What we've gone through, what we are going through and might go through again and again in our nation is a sure blessing of God. He is telling us, "I love you. Listen to me. You young people need to hear me. The Lord loves you, and when we are suffering in any way concerning persecution or even the heavens being closed up, God is telling us, I love you. I love you."
Hey.
We can either turn such trials into stepping stones of grace, or we can complain and set our hearts in a different direction for God. I'm pleading with you to understand what God is doing is because he loves us.
Amen.
Let's do everything in our power to keep preaching the word of God.
Amen.
It may be our children's damnation Yes. Been out there.
Amen.
Years ago, I met a missionary to Australia in a missions conference in North Georgia. And he made the statement, he said, I am what they call a three-time loser. He said, I was guilty of murder. He said, I was guilty of embezzlement. And he said, I was guilty of hatred. And he said, the end result was, I was judged by prison. And he said, I went off to prison. He said, I'm on the top bunk. And he said, I remember my grandmother had taught me in Sunday school the Word of God. He said, while I was laying on top of that bunk, I became very deeply convicted of my sin. And he said, it's because of my remembering the verse, Romans 5:8, that my grandmother had taught me in Sunday school and God saved me.
Amen.
He said, there is no way I could have gotten out of prison. But they put me up on parole. And he said, I came out. Then he said, and now for the last 15 years, I've been a missionary in Australia. Just let me say this to you. God can change one through the power of the Word of God if it's 10 years later like it was in this past life.
Right.
Amen. This seed, hey, I know this. We went out to go on the farm at 9 years old. And we had to rebuild the porch and some things. So while we're digging down, my dad said to me, look what I found. And he held it up from underneath that old farmhouse. A jar of seeds. And it had been in there for, I don't know, this rusty cap. And the bottle was not broken, but it sure did look bad. And dad said, we're going to see if these things grow. He set them in a certain place and set them out so we could see. And everyone came. He said, what, this is the old seed.